It's not every day that you get to fly with the Hurricane Hunters.
Our First Morning meteorologist, Brooke Silvering, she did. She is brave. Take a look at her report.
Sitting in that seat, it's really special. You're part of a long line of people that have operated this plane that was built for NOAA in the early 70s.
The infamous Miss Piggy and her counterpart Kermit fly through tropical systems, collecting data at 10,000 feet.
If you look at the back left side of the plane, there's all the storms that it's gone through over the years. And if you look at the flags, it's operated all over the world. It's a very, very special plane.
David Keith is a lieutenant commander with NOAA Corp and a hurricane hunter. They fly in and out of the storms, collecting data and the current atmospheric conditions. Missions can take up to 10 hours.
I think people get captivated, or it's all about the models, right? But a model doesn't work without data. We're out over here over the ocean.
Reporting somewhere over the Atlantic Ocean, I'm meteorologist Brooke Silvering.
And I got to tell you, when you walked into the newsroom yesterday, we were all so very happy to
see
you.
Yes, I was like, she's here. She's well.
We knew you were up there in the skies. And my first question to you, of course, was, were you okay in terms of the turbulence? Because you do go through a lot of turbulence. You go through some pretty up and down flying that. And you handled it like
it's
a champ.
Up and down. I did take some anti-nausea stuff. I think that was the key. And also just like to being too nervous to eat. But it was really cool experience. Like there was turbulence. You're going up and down. And then it's pretty bumpy for the most part. When you're flying through clouds, you know, you don't feel it until, you know, you get through the turbulence of the clouds, and then that's when you start to feel the drops. And I do remember the pressure dropping at a point. You feel the whole plane just go, oh, yeah.
But what they are doing there, let's talk seriously, Brooke, about the work that's being done. As you heard Lieutenant David Keith say, I mean, the model doesn't work without the data. I mean, the data that is being collected on one of those trips is remarkable.
It is so crucial. So they're constantly dropping drop-zones down into the sky, and then those are able to collect, you know, the data, like what's happening with the temperatures, the dew points, everything pretty much in the atmosphere. They're able to detect the winds, and all that data is just being fed back constantly, and that's how the models are, you know, put into the models, and it's updated, and that's how we're able to, you know, get a better forecast and have more precise predictions of what's going to be happening with the storm. It's so cool.
How long are those flights, too?
About 10 hours, so it was a long flight. I know, I thought Las Vegas was a long flight from one way to the other. No, this trumps it.
Because you guys have to get up there. You have to fly to the storm, fly up, down, around, inside of the storm. So it takes a long time.
It takes a very long time, and I was fortunate enough that one of my classmates from Florida State University, she's a coordinator for these flights. So she wasn't on this one, but the other person that was coordinating, and they do so much work with their, you know, they're planning on flying through what wind speeds they can make it through and what's going to be too dangerous. So it's a lot of thought and process, a lot of moving parts goes into these missions.
And how often are they doing these right now with Nicole where the storm is right now?
Right. They're flying out there. You know, some days they have two trips coming out, and there's other planes. I did learn. So there's another plane called Gonzo, and this one, they're all Muppets themed, right? This one flies in the higher upper levels of the atmosphere. So this is so cool. I thought this was really fascinating. So what that plane does is it flies around the storm, and then with the data that it gets from the outside of the storm with how big the wind field is, that's how they're able to condense the cone. So you see the cone gradually getting smaller. Mm-hmm. It's from the readings from that storm. And then, you know, the updates of the wind speeds and, you know, how low the pressure is from the planes flying at the bottom. So it's also fascinating.
One of the things I've always heard, too, is that moment that you come through all the clouds and you get into the eye.
Yeah.
Talk a little bit
how
about that. We saw that video.
So that video that you guys saw is we were piercing through the clouds. So that was probably like the bumpiest part. And then it does calm down. So there's a really big change in it all.
And without the precise data, the important work that they're doing, we would not have the accuracy of the cone, of the forecast, of knowing when, where, how strong, right?
Exactly. So it's all very crucial. And it's just, you know, all these little things put together in one. And this is how we're able to have a product.
And at one point on your flight, you were hit with a lot of hail.
Yes, we had grapple coming in. So it's basically like hail. And they were like, uh-oh, we should probably avoid that, you know, one cell. So it's really so fascinating. Like as a meteorologist, I think all of us, like, this is our biggest dream to have that opportunity to be inside of a storm, and it's just really also fascinating.
Well, it is fascinating, and we're so grateful for the work that those hurricane hunters
right.
do. I mean, they have helped you all, and as you said, each year the forecasting gets better and better because of the work that they're doing by flying into those storms.
Right.
And we're mostly just thankful that they delivered you back to
yes.
us safely.
Oh, you should have seen us all when she walked back into the newsroom.
Here she is.